Hey guys, we're gonna get started. We haven't gotten food yet. There is plenty of pizza left. Some drinks as well. Welcome to the Austin Hardware Startup Meetup. By show of hands, how many of you, is this your first meetup ever? Awesome. Wow, meetup, not just Austin Startup Hardware Meetup. First meetup ever. Fantastic. How many of you, is this the first time you've been to a meetup, but this is the first time you've been to our meetup? Fantastic. So welcome. Our community is pretty strong. Just in this meetup alone, and this meetup group alone, there's 1,200 people in the email list. Before the end of the night, I'll pop up that slide again so you can see what that email is, or it's on the meetup page. This community is actually really friendly, believe it or not. If you have a question, if you have a specific hiring need, send along an email to the list, as long as it's the same email address that you signed up to meetup.com with. This group of us is a mix of entrepreneurs, hardware hackers, and everything in between. What we share in common is trying to bring products to market. It's hard. Building prototypes is easier than it used to be, but that's still hard. But building prototypes that can scale is still extremely hard. Finding the right partners and manufacturers. A lot of people in this room have been through it before and are willing to share their lessons learned, share what they did right, but more importantly, what they did wrong. And then there are other people in this room that are just starting out. So I welcome you. I hope you'll come to another meetup. I hope you'll engage with each other after. And the typical format is we usually have a few demos of people in various stages of product development. And if you'd like to demo at a future meetup, please email me either through the meetup interface or dave@foundry.net. The demos can be very quick. As you'll see, we typically like to keep them about 10 minutes with some room for questions. And you don't have to have a finished product. You don't have to actually have something that works or communicates to the internet. But it's really about sharing what you're working on. And if you have a specific need or question, a lot of times this group here can offer some advice. After the demos, we have usually one or two featured speakers. And then at the end, we do a general call for announcements. So if there's something that you're working on, you'd like to tell the group about, if there's a position that you're hiring for, you'd like to tell the group about, or if you're just new and want to ask a question specific to the hardware community, feel free to do that too. So after that, we typically break, schmooze, and the one thing I'll ask is if you can just clean up around you towards the end so that your organizer doesn't have to do it all. So let's get started. Our first demo is a company called Reserve Strap. We're lucky to have Lane Musgrave here to, well, the founder, to demo it. So Reserve Strap is actually a device, okay, I'll steal your thunder a little
bit. Go ahead.
It's a device that will charge your Apple Watch while you wear it. And from what I hear about the battery life, I think this product's gonna be very successful. So hand things over to Lane.
Yeah, I've got things here for you guys to check out.
Oh, thank you. Hi everyone, I'm Lane. My partner John Arrow is also here. So John is the founder of Mutual Mobile, app development company here in town, and he's still chairman of the board there. And I got my start at Nike doing like product design and UX UI on the Fuel Band and like Nike Plus experiences. But John's a serial entrepreneur, and this is my first company and my first hardware project. So, like David said, the Reserve Strap is gonna be the first way to charge the Apple Watch on your wrist. So, just to give you guys some background, like the Apple Watch got announced in October of last year, and one of the biggest omissions from their keynote was any discussion of battery life. And as you guys know, if Apple has something good to say about something in their products, they're gonna say it. So that omission was like a glaring problem that we identified. So as early as like November, we got started on some early designs for how to charge the Apple Watch and extend its battery life. And our goal has always been to double the battery life. So based on typical usage, it's around 18 hours, and so we're trying to add an additional 18 to 20 hours of battery life to the watch. So the band's being passed around, but it's a pretty basic design. It's three lithium polymer cells, with like around 500 to 600 milliamp hours of capacity, and a circuit board that handles power management, and a micro USB port for recharging. Like when you're running low on battery, you turn it on, and it juices up your watch. So we are targeting a November 3rd ship date. We're moving very quickly, and right now we're in the final design stage. Like we've had a final design for a few weeks now. We're just doing testing and making sure it's exactly what we want to manufacture. So I'd love to hear you guys' feedback. Like the current big questions I have are related to sourcing. Like we considered doing it in China because it's so cheap, but we ended up deciding, since it's our first hardware project, that we really wanted to keep it local and pay a premium to have it done here because we can do faster iterations and get things done more quickly. And we've had a tough time kind of like finding great sources. I emailed the group a few weeks ago looking for injection molding manufacturers and got some great leads from everyone. Thank you for that. But we're sending out quotes and getting things back, but they've been pretty varied. So that would be really helpful. Another big question I have is related to certification. Our device is a non-intentionally emitting device. It doesn't intentionally radiate anything, but there is residual radiation from the batteries and circuit board, but it's very small. But I'm not sure whether certification is worth it. I've heard some people say don't do it at all. Other people say it's extremely important. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. And yeah, those are the main things. If you guys have any questions about the product or process,
How do you connect to the watch to put the power into the watch?
Oh, I did not cover that. So our the Apple Watch charges using magnetic induction, which is the same way like a Sonicare toothbrush or Tesla charges. There's no direct metal-to-metal contact. It wirelessly charges through the back of the watch. So that was our earliest design, was that using that wireless induction method. What we discovered, which was like a massive breakthrough, we were the first people to utilize this like hidden port, and it's this little 6-pin port that's in the side of the watch where it slides in. So as soon as the watch came out, our first goal was to prove that we could not charge to that port and that we would go forward with the wireless design. But much to our benefit, we discovered we could charge to that port, but it required a bit of tinkering and experimentation, and we bricked probably 4 or 5 watches in the process. But so yeah, that's where charging, and it really simplified our design, increased our efficiency. The inductive charging was going to get like 40% of the battery capacity to the watch, and now we're up to 80 or 90% efficiency. So that was really important to our design. Yep.
Did you choose the batteries just because they could flex?
It was a balance between fitting as much capacity as we could while retaining flexibility in the band. We experimented with curved lithium polymers, which are actually quite useful. Like the fuel, we use those for the fuel band, but the fuel band is a hard case, and lithium polymers are really fragile. So in a flexible band like ours, they just weren't feasible because any like small hit would break them. So, and they're really unstable, they can catch fire. So so we went with 3 batteries. 2 wasn't gonna give us enough flexibility in the band, and 4 was gonna take up too much space and doesn't utilize it best. So we're doing 3, like basically 3 links in the band. Yeah. Did that answer your question?
Yes.
All right.
Does it cause any heating issues when charging?
It does. It does cause, it does get a little bit hot, but it's not, it's like, it's kind of like your phone gets warm when it charges. Like it's minimal, but it's not enough to cause an issue, but we're still taking steps to minimize that by choosing heat insulating rubbers. Like, there are some rubbers that insulate heat better than others. And with our design, the other strap is actually inside instead of on the outside, like most watch bands. So that inside strap will insulate the heat from the batteries. So we're hoping it's not an issue, but it's certainly an issue, but we're hoping it's minor. Yep.
What's the price point for this going for the customer?
So it's $249. And we chose that because we wanted to choose the, like, given this is our first hardware project, we knew we didn't want to have extremely high volume. So we early on we tested it out, and we weren't sure if it was the right price, but we got so much press within, like, the Apple community, and we got a ton of demand at that price point. So it is high, but it's perfect for us because we've gotten a ton of traction, and we've gotten a massive amount of pre-orders, like more than we ever expected at that price point. But it's perfect for us because it gives us enough wiggle room to be able to manufacture domestically and still hit our margins. And it also keeps volume down, so we don't have to be making like 5,000. We're gonna have a smaller early run. Yep.
What's the live show?
Well, lithium polymers have a fixed number of cycles, so everyone's bound by that. Like, you guys have all had devices that, like laptops, that crap out after 2 or 3 years. So we're bound by that in terms of the number of cycles our cells can recharge with, and the watch is bound by that same thing. But fortunately, if you use a reserve strap, and use that power first before your watch battery, that's a lot easier to replace than your watch battery. But we are doing a lot of durability testing, and we want it to last until Apple Watch 2. So, yeah.
You said use the band first and then the watch. Is that software controllable in the watch or something?
Yeah, so the watch, when it's given power to that port, decides it uses that first before the internal battery. So if your watch is at 100% and you turn the reserve strap on, the Apple Watch doesn't discriminate between that power and the power in the band in the watch. So it'll use reserve strap's power first, and then once that's depleted, then it will switch over and use its internal battery. Does that make sense? Okay. Yep.
Do you know if this is a diagnostic port that software updates can turn off?
Theoretically, yes. That's certainly a risk. But given that it is a diagnostic port, like, Apple needs it just as much as we do. And we have been in talks with Apple. Like, we've been talking internally with them, and we've gotten a lot of positive feedback. Apple doesn't have an MFI program yet for the Apple Watch like they do for the iPhone and iPad. And it's really early on for accessories, so I'm not surprised. Like, when the first iPhone came out, it took them 2 years to announce the App Store. So like, it's a new product for them, and they're learning too. So it's something, it's a risk, but it's a risk we're happy to take right now. Yep.
Did you have any software issues? Like, the watch probably was not designed to be charged when you walk around with it, right?
Yeah. It was a challenge. Like, it took us a few weeks to figure out how to charge it, but it was pretty straightforward. I mean, it didn't take us that long, and the fact that you just the placement of the port and the way it was designed, and like what we discovered about its functionality, almost like begged the question of like why they put it there, why they allowed the like data bus and like it's basically like a USB port that's aligned differently. We just had to figure out how to talk to it, but the fact that they included all they did there is just like it's just too, like, it just begs accessories. So even if they haven't announced that yet, we're pretty confident that it is an accessory port.
How did you find out the details of that port? Was there some, they didn't publish anything, did they? Did you just do a bunch of probing?
We broke like four or five, but that's all I'm gonna say. It was challenging, but we figured it out. All right, thank you everyone. All right, and if you wanna check it out, it's reservestrap.com, and my email is lane@reservestrap.com if you guys have any feedback on certification or sources for injection molding, that would be awesome.
I assume Lane wants his prototype spec. Those aren't giveaways, right?
No.
Okay, no. Thanks, Lane. Our next and final demo is a company called EnviroC, and we have Jonathan Davis here to present what I'm standing in front of, which is an IoT asset tracking device for the data center. Did I say that correctly?
You did.
Fantastic.
I just put the laptop up. Okay, I think we're going to switch to a clip-on mic. I'm going to have to log in here. Down, they don't have a problem. I'm just going to restart the app. Okay, I'm John Davis. I'm with EnviroC. And what we're going to look at today is going to be very quick and very short. And that's one of the really neat things about this is there's not a lot to demo. I have to carry around this 100-pound kit just to give it context. It's a small sensor strip. It will connect into a computer rack. And what this does simply is it will track all of your assets throughout your entire data center estate. That's something that's been very difficult to accomplish. I'm in this space, more in the software side of it, for maintaining connectivity and assets in the data center. And this was something that our customer is always asking for. When are you going to automate this process? We don't audit our data centers. You know, we have thousands of servers, maybe tens of thousands. It's very labor intensive, it's just a mess. So it would make an IT manager, a director, or somebody who has to do this very excited, but it's not consumer facing. I can't go to Kickstarter, we're having to do this the hard way, but we've had some success. And so before I do this, let me just introduce the slide. This is the problem we're solving. The work order and any other moves, adds, or changes in the data center are going to refer to a location. The assets get lost over a couple of months and especially years. And so this is a conceptual drawing of how crazy things could get in the future. But right now, I could show you rows and rows and rows where things are getting lost, and that time is money. And when you have an outage that's a consumer-facing website, or it's a back-end process that your company has to have, let's say manufacturing, you can't afford to lose these assets. You can't afford to not maintain them when you lose a drive or you lose a power supply. So we came up with this, and one of the things that makes us different is there are several solutions out there that do roughly what we do. They're very expensive. They cost more per asset than the problem they're trying to solve. And so that's why we had to design this, and thinking that we're going to solve a much bigger problem, and that is the cost of the current solutions. Okay, it's very simple to demo. So here we have just a typical data center row, and the magic of this sensor is we're not a software company, we're just building this for demo purposes. This rack is just to give it context, but I'll show you exactly what it does. We'll bring a rack forward. So you have some assets that are tagged with our tags. These tags we're getting out of China for 20 cents. There are some other solutions that are 18 bucks a tag, or there's some that are a little cheaper. So think of that when I'm just a piece of plastic and 20 cents, I can tag the asset. The strip we're looking at right here that I'm about to demonstrate, I believe it has $7 or $8 worth of parts on it, and it could be up to 16 U long. That's, let's say, 1/4 of a rack. We have pushed the price as low as possible, and as we see it, and we did get validation of this. So since I don't have a lapel mic, I'm going to have to set the mic down. But as you can see, I can pick up a server. It's going to leave the screen because it has left the rack. Put it back in, the sensor is going to sense that. Now, it's that simple. I just demoed the essence of this piece of this sensor and the Internet of Things for servers, or the Internet of Things that power the Internet of Things. One more thing that I'll bring up, security. Security is very important. I'm going to shove an unauthorized asset. It has no tag. I'm going to shove that in there, and we're going to be able to alert somebody that is maintaining their data center that this occurred. And so, what is this going to do? Well, security is more important than it ever has been. And so for a 20-cent tag, and roughly, our cost manufacturer is about $60 for a full rack. We are maintaining a location and very certainty about where the location is on, you know, roughly $20,000, $30,000 worth of assets for just under $100. We probably would retail this for about $250. Now, we had some success very quickly when we designed the first prototype. A billion-dollar manufacturer engaged us. They saw us on LinkedIn. We went through four different prototype rounds, and we had one thing that was interesting. We got the benefit of their research. They helped us create more prototypes that were more focused based on their PhD research, but we had non-disclosures, we have a patent pending, and so they own nothing, but we got the benefit of working with them. We couldn't come to terms. They built their own strip that was much like ours, specifically in form and function, but it was using a different technology. I don't think there's any actionable patent infringement, but it just was validation of what we're doing. And we demoed at Tech Breakfast about a month ago, and then lightning struck again. Now another Austin company that is the dominant player in this space, but in a different technology, we're now talking with them about partnering. So some people have a startup that is business to business focused, and it seems very hard to make it work because you can't go out to Kickstarter and find funding. Well, there's another way, but you know, it sometimes takes a lot of phone calls and a whole lot of doing just this. So that's pretty much it, and I'll open up for questions.
Did you talk about the tag technology, or as far as like tracking the assets, I guess what kind of range or what happened if you brought across the range or something like that?
You know, you brought up some great questions that really helped me encapsulate what this is for people who don't understand it. So this uses near field technology. When you're tracking an asset to a use space, and a use space is the common delineation of where a computer is sitting in a rack, you only have 1.75 inches of space, let's say on a 1U server. I can't have a system that can throw that that coupling, that radio coupling out feet, because then I can't track to the use space. So this is inches. It's about an inch worth of space. And that helps us with not having to have so much precision in this. You can be a couple, half inch left, half inch right, half inch forward, half inch back. And we usually are going to get it right in the right use space. We also have abilities to discriminate when we're seeing an asset in two spots, how to figure it out. So that's a great question. It's EMS 4200. These are animal tags. This is commonly used to tag pigeons. And oddly enough, in this Chinese brochure, it said for pigeon racing. But it's also used in smart cards, cat cards. You know, it's very common. So the source is very easy to track down in China and do custom work to.
So did you mention each tag is 20 cents, or what is the price of the tags themselves?
So we're sourcing, we're just buying hundreds. We're on a, we're just prototype, we're not in production. And we're sourcing these for about 20 cents a piece. If we did it in bulk, it's gonna go way down. So the magic isn't in the tag, because in a data center, a lot of people are using the same kind of tags, or maybe ultra high frequency tags that are maybe 75 cents a piece. But they're having to go up to that rack and scan, or at least stand near that rack and throw out that field to activate the tags. So that's still a manual process. Did I answer the question? I lost my train of thought there.
Yeah, because I originally introduced those tags as just like some piece of plastic that has a number on it.
Yes, so it is fact. We had a camera. I've got a tag on the end of this. It's just very simple, tiny little disc that we encased into our own epoxy. So 20 cent tag that could go down to probably 10 cents. So the magic is in the strip and being able to read a rack for less than, you know, $2 per asset, because that seems to be the sweet spot.
Yes. So is there a strip of sensors down the side of the rack that's just like looking for each one of these guys to figure out who's sitting in there?
So instead of me dismounting that one, this is another for you section. This is we often in demo sessions with the manufacturers that we are hoping to deal with. We just pass this around. We have it connected to the laptop. So this sensor would be 7 foot tall. It's maybe 48U, 54U. Gotcha. The thing that we need to solve is that becomes very flimsy when it's this thin. We're looking for a mechanical engineer potentially to join the very small team that would maybe work for equity, but we have money. If we have to, we'll spend it. We know how to connect these electrically and do a robust connection. But we don't know how to take, 2 foot strips, connect these all together, and make sure that this lasts over time. Because they're gonna get bumped. And so the mechanical connection between, they're gonna be 12 U sections. That mechanical connection to protect our electrical connection is something we're not good at. We really only have ideas. We don't know how to execute them. So we are looking for somebody that might wanna join this and, you know, let's see how it goes.
Yeah. What does the other end plug into?
So for convenience, for demoing purposes, we just stuck a USB, you know, this is a serial output. We just stuck USB on this. In practice, it's going to be a common standard, if you're familiar with them, I2C, RS485, something that a manufacturer can get the data out of the rack. We don't want to get into that business. We want to be in the business of selling these strips and connecting them to something else that gets that data stream out of the rack.
What's your email in case they are interested in that or the job?
jdavis@envirac.com. And I've got business cards. And so this isn't a job. This is, we're looking for someone to help build, you know. Again, we are being courted by another major manufacturer, but we've already done this. We need to do it all, have a plan to do it ourselves. And so the major manufacturers say, oh, we'll solve that, but only if we're willing to play ball with each other, and that may not happen. So, definitely I'd like to talk to anybody that has experience in this area. It's not a big job, but it takes specific expertise we don't have. So.
Thank you.
All right, thanks for letting us demo today.
Maybe another round of applause, since Jonathan had to carry this all the way up. took a lot of dedication. Thanks again. The next speaker, our featured speaker, comes to us from a company called Pushstart Creative. And I've actually done work with these guys and highly recommend that if you're looking for design, industrial design, or someone to just help you through the product design process. How many of you were at our last meetup with Jeff Dotchess? Okay, a few of you. I guess I could have just figured out how many of you were new and then subtracted. Jeff Dotchess was talking about how he came to build a beautifully designed intelligent glucometer. And his message, his main message last month was design experiences, not hardware. And that dovetails really nicely into the talk that Adrian Taylor is going to give. Adrian is a partner at Pushstart Creative. And Pushstart helps people design beautiful connected things and beautiful things, period. It's hard to know when to include design in your product development process. Obviously, your product has to work, but look at the Nest thermostat. If you were to tell me a few years ago that someone was going to go after a market that was extremely well established, like the thermostat, just make it look good, I would have laughed in their face, and I have two in my place now. So clearly design has a large part to play. So please will you give a warm welcome to Adrian Taylor as he talks about design and hardware.
Good evening. Folks, I know it's end of the day, it's pizza setting in, two demos already. I'll try to be as lively as possible, at least dart about up here so you can keep your eyes track. So I'm going to talk about design. I think design is a word that gets thrown around a lot, means a lot of things to a lot of different people. I'm going to take you down the path of sort of how we define it, what it means to us in the world of product development. Dave, thanks for the intro. You kind of understand who I am. My background's in interactive, been doing that for over 15 years and built a couple of creative teams and managed them at some different agencies before co-founding an agency about 3.5 years ago. We're, a convergence agency. We're sort of half industrial design, half interactive design, and so we've been really interested in the world of IoT and connected devices. Just a couple shots of some things we've worked on. So I think if I polled this room, right, and probably polled everyone in the Capital Factory and probably polled the entrepreneurial community in Austin, they'd be like, yeah, design, it's totally important. So how, what does that mean? What are you gonna do? How are you gonna change your process? Well, design's important, so we're gonna use it. If we look around the media landscape, if we look around the bestsellers list for the past decade, design and business have sort of propelled themselves into the mainstream of our consciousness. And I think we can say that, I mean, product design has been around, you know, as long as products have been being developed. It's not a new concept per se, but it's gaining a level of attention, and especially amongst the connected device space and the entrepreneurial space for a couple reasons. And before we jump into kind of how I think design plays in the process, just want to kind of set the stage a little bit. So I think there's a couple of driving market forces, you know, that we've seen really ramp up in the past decade and a half that I think are sort of changing how consumers, and I'm going to talk mostly about the consumer market, but honestly, this applies, you know, right across B2B as well. I think that the idea that B2B customers are incredibly different than B2C customers is sort of an outdated concept. But I think there's a couple of key factors that are important for us to consider. They're good reminders of why we want to care and why we want to focus on this. The fact is that, and I joke with my friends who have MBAs, is that a lot of sort of the rules we learned about the market, about being either first to market or being the feature leader, or, you know, being the price point advantage, a lot of these are starting to quickly erode because, honestly, in a globalized economy, and an economy where it's so hard to protect IP, it's just moving faster and faster. So you can have a great idea today, you can launch a product tomorrow, and there'll be somebody who's making the same thing cheaper the next week. So a lot of these rules of how we box out and how we try to cut off a sliver of the market space just don't really apply anymore. And because of that, because the barrier to entry is so low now too, there's just this proliferation. I did a quick Amazon search for 55-inch TVs, and I got 522 options. You do a quick Google search for best 55-inch TV and you get 2 billion some odd options of page results. So the amount of products that a consumer can particularly consider is just skyrocketing. And so meanwhile, you've also seen this trend towards sort of the fancification of products. You're seeing a lot of what I would call design as decoration. A lot of like, oh yeah, Target took what Walmart did and then made it designy. So that's a business model. We'll just make everything cooler looking, and that's design. But I would argue that design, and the design that differentiates in the product space is really experience. And I'm sure I'm not saying anything that doesn't ring true, right? Brand is experience, and experience is complicated. And this is why design is tricky, because if we think about how we experience the world, it is multi-leveled, and we could probably, you know, get a behavioral and a cognitive and a bunch of psychologists here, and they could talk to us about all of our experiences. It's tricky stuff, right? I mean, first off, it's just physical. We just have some ways in which we touch and interact with the world. And when you talk about especially convergence products that have maybe a manufactured good that then talks to a digital service, and so you're starting to interact with things in multiple ways and in multiple times during your days, the level of complexity just sort of ramps up. What we want to do is cut through, you know, the experiential noise to give people a product or service experience that resonates, that's meaningful. This is why people are really opening their wallets right now. Sure, there's always gonna be a guy making the cheap one, and sometimes you're gonna choose the cheapest option. There's always gonna be other motivators that drive people to make buying decisions. But I think more and more what we're seeing is that really great experiences are what make really awesome brands. People are signing up for things that make their life easier and more meaningful, that they can connect with, that they're proud to be a part of, that they can, you know, symbolize the way in which they want to interact with the world. And so the idea of products with interfaces on them, or digital services that have physical products, or none of these things that sort of make up IoT or the connected device space are really new concepts, right? I think it's just that the market's gotten so crowded and so competitive that it just matters more. You can't just have a feature. A feature doesn't win anymore, because someone else can just make that feature, right? There used to be, you know, we work with GE, and you know, their appliance group, it used to just be like, haha, you can't make this oven that I can make, because it has these huge tools and these complicated processes, and a startup can't do it. But the barrier to entry on everything has gotten so low that other people can do it. So now you can't just sort of stand on your feature soapbox and sell through to people. You have to realize that you're competing against everyone else in that space, and trying to connect with people in a meaningful way matters. So when I talk about experience, I mean every experience. Everything is part of your brand, right? If brand is not a logo and a name or a color palette, brand is every touch point, every little moment at which your potential consumer or the consumer you're trying to retain interacts with your company. So it's the way that your phone tree works, right? It's what music you play on hold. But for the purposes of developing a product, it's really making good decisions about every little touch point. And I think Tumblr's a nice example in that when they came on the scene and they were trying to really differentiate from things like WordPress and trying to say, like, look, blogging should be simple. Like, it's not, like, you don't need to be a technologist to start a blog. It's easy. And when you used to first hit their sign-up page, all you get is just three little boxes that say, they just clear everything out of the way and just sort of symbolize to you. That was their brand really coming through down to that little micro experience. Now, that's the way we need to think about every little decision we make, whether it be, you know, color finish material on, you know, our shop parts, whether it be what's that login screen look like on our website. All those little things have to convey. Is your company about security? Is it about speed? Is it about, you know, being cute and cheeky? Like, whatever that is, that needs to be there in every time I interact with your brand. And that, you know, for better or for worse, we are hyper-connected now. And so your customers become your marketing department, right? Word of mouth and reviews and the way in which people can share opinions. You know, I mean, try to imagine like a world of Kickstarter without social media, right? You know, when we did a Kickstarter campaign, you look at where that traffic comes off the street, and a lot of it is through Twitter. A lot of it is through Facebook, right? There is this great network now that can drive awareness and attention if you're putting something forth that people can get excited about. But that is a double-sided coin, right? Because if you're putting something out there that has problems, that doesn't stay true to its brand, well, that comes back in your face as well. All right, so when do I need to involve design, right? It's important. Yes, Adrian, we get it. We all know that already, thank you. All right, design, I'm in. When do we do it? Well, we do it early, we do it often. I think, you know, as a design consultancy, and I'll talk about kind of the different ways in which you can bring design into your organization. This isn't like a Pushstart pitch. Speaking from our experience, you know, we get a lot of folks that walk in the door, they've got a really cool technology or an awesome idea, and they just kind of missed the market fit for it, or it's got some just horrible usability issue, or it's just, yeah, it's branded for, you know, 13-year-old girls, but it's really for, you know, 48-year-old men. And there's just some miss, and they've really invested through in that. And now they're in a place where it's like, okay, we'll fix it. And it's like, okay, we can do that. Unfortunately, that's a pretty painful Band-Aid to rip off. So I don't think you have to go out the first time you have that aha moment and start spending money on designers if you don't consider yourself one. But I do think you want to build that into your culture as much as possible, that idea of thinking and thinking about the user. Yeah, rework is expensive. I also think that there is a trap in the world of design to say that it's never done, right? And I think, you know, folks coming out of the hardware space, folks coming out of the software space, I think have a better understanding of this idea of get something, ship it, get it out there, get feedback. And that's the same with design. You know, the minute you launch your product and the minute people start experiencing it, doesn't mean your design is done or that your brand is dead. Brands evolve, smart, the best brands, you know, if you look at your favorite brands today, and like go in the Wayback Machine and look at their site from 5 or 10 years ago, it's not gonna be the same. You'll see that DNA, you'll see how they evolved, but you gotta get stuff out there, you gotta get feedback. This is the process that at the highest level that we sort of look at when it comes to designing a product. I don't think this will be surprising or shocking to anybody. You know, starts with an idea, quick validation, and then research. Research is, from a designer's perspective, research is about the user and the user's context. That's what we really care about, right? We want to understand this target audience that we're trying to get to, really understand what their needs are, how they're going to act with it, what their day's like, and then what are their other reference points, what are the similar products they're using, what are their touchstones, right? Strategy is what some people might call brand definition. There's a point at which you start to understand your audience and you understand your competitive market space and you say, okay, how do we fit into that? And I think what commonly happens is that people think about, oh, my features or my price point or my manufacturing process, that's one set of decisions. And then my logo and my color palette and, you know, if I'm gonna use rubber, that's another set of decisions. And I would argue that they should be being made at the same time by the same group of people as much as possible. I think you undervalue what you can get out of a design thinker in that business strategy portion. And I think you miss the boat, you know, as a designer, if you're not open to getting involved in that decision, in that business decision-making process, because coming up with that brand promise and that feature set and that go-to-market strategy and that price point, all that is the same thing, because that's how your end customer ultimately ends up experiencing it. They don't separate it out. They're not going like, oh, well, this price point makes me feel this way, but then I look at their logo, it makes me feel that way. It's one experience for them. So the more you can bring that together, the more you benefit. I'll dive into the other sections in a little bit once we start to talk about the kind of design roles and the kind of folks you might interact with. So I will share a couple of quick things that we find to be pretty true when we're designing for connected devices. The first is this idea of focusing the process around a very clear target. We use personas. I don't know if a lot of folks out there have used this before. It's a pretty common technique, very helpful. Whether you're doing, and I believe in, you know, guerrilla research. I don't necessarily think you need to spend a lot of money on research. I think if you're smart and motivated, there's, you know, great web analytics, there's secondary research you can beg, borrow, and steal. You can go out to where your community, your target community lives, works, and breathes and spy on them. There's lots of great ways to collect data, but ultimately you get a bunch of data. It's pretty hard to make decisions on a big pile of data. So often we sculpt those into sort of these archetypal people that are aligned to our market segments, and that becomes shorthand. And it becomes a reference for the team. And what you want to, the thing that's so challenging about design is that at the end of the day, it involves a lot of very subjective decision-making, right? Should it be blue or should it be red? Well, my kid likes blue, let's go blue. That should not be the decision-making process. It should be, you know, what is this guy's name? What does Eric like? What does Eric think the color should be, right? And when you're working with big teams, as you often are when you're doing, you know, complex connected devices, you need these shorthands, you need these cheats, and you need something that takes it out of any individual's subjective opinion and brings it into a team-based decision around the user. I'm gonna go fast, I got a lot of slides. No. So the other tool we use is basically shorthand for the brand. So again, you got a lot of folks involved. You got maybe an interface designer, you got an ID guy, you've got a front-end developer, you got a bunch of different people, and they all need to have the same vision in their head, right? We might not have sorted this all out, right? If the company is 3 years old and you come into it, you know what the brand is, you can work within it. If this is a net new thing that you're building, what's the shorthand? So we use a lot of these mood boards, super helpful. It's like if you go back, if you remember like doing like collages when you were a kid in school, it's like that. It's about finding referential elements that can get a group of people to have a shared vision. Because talking about experience and talking about design is very hard. You know, you say one thing, like it'll be really slick, and I'm like picturing something, it'll be kind of curvy and dark. Yeah, okay. And I'm picturing one thing, you're picturing something completely different. So to get something down on paper so that when, the guy who's writing the little JavaScript transition, on our mobile web version has the same idea of what we mean by, this brand's sexy as the guy who's designing the handle, for the part that plugs in, right? So it's about having a shorthand that a very complex team can rally around. It's also about narrative. I think, user flows, very powerful tools. Storyboards, I think, are even more powerful. When you look at a lot of connected devices, it's really a day in the life consideration, right? Like, these objects come into or out of our daily experience in very interesting ways. And storytelling is a very powerful medium that I think as humans we always respond really well to. And so again, this is another tool just to galvanize the team. Flexibility, critical, right? I mean, as we move through these products, we find that it's so easy to sort of, hit a wall and sort of decide that what you were marching towards is now wrong. But I think anytime you can find a way to bob and weave that doesn't undermine that original core goal, that's a win, right? So this is an example where we're working on a multiplayer business simulation. And so the idea was that we had too many assumptions. We had too many question marks to really invest in the cost of producing this thing. So we just made a paper version, right? Put it in front of a bunch of users, got a ton of feedback, and moved on. So finding those things when you hit those hurdles that don't undermine the original goal, but give you learning opportunities. And then I don't think this is gonna be anything that this community doesn't think already, but make, test, learn, repeat, right? This idea of you can't just sit there with your assumptions marching towards the finish line and then make the prototype at the end and go, wow, that does not work like I wanted. You have to build early and build often. And that can be a chunk of foam core that you walk around with and be like, if it's that big, that's a problem. No one's gonna wanna carry that to work. It can be very low fidelity, but the more you build, the more you experience, the more you're designing from experience as your user would be. I'm gonna skip that. All right, so let's talk about the designer species in the wild you might find. I think there's four groups that are probably particularly meaningful for people developing connected products. You've got sort of your, and these certainly are not always four people. Sometimes two of these are one person. Like, there's a lot of ways to configure this, but I think there's sort of four archetypes of people you might interact with. Some of them might be you might fill this role yourself. But research and strategy, is a really critical role. And I think in that, as I was talking about that sort of idea of making both your business and product feature-based decisions while you're making your design decisions, this is the kind of person that helps out with that, right? This is the kind of person who is really awesome at synthesis. They can bring a lot of crazy points together and say, that means we go here. And then you go, yeah, that's what we do, right? That might be somebody inside the company already. That might be a role you wanna interact with. Industrial designer, again, you guys probably know who this is. This is gonna be the person who's actually responsible for the physical form of the object. Your interface designer, again, gonna be working both with your user flows, your UX, and then in theory into your front end look and feel, your GUI. And then graphic designers, again, so that could be your interface designer, could be a different person, but again, a super important thing, I think we always see things where people are like, all right, product looks awesome, UI looks awesome, we didn't do a box, we forgot to do packaging. There's all these little hidden extra moments. Right, we need like that little booklet when you open the box, it tells you how to use it, or maybe just a nice card with a QR code or whatever. But there's all these little elements that float around your first product and your first company that may make you interact with this type of person. So again, That could be four people, that could be six or eight people, or that could be two people. drilling back into the process and looking kind of at the roles and the deliverables that those kind of people create. So, you know, user research, contextual personas, opportunity analysis, we sort of talked about that. Strategy and brand positioning, you know, really giving that core feature that you guys are going to be able to reference throughout the process and not lose one's way. Ideation. So one thing we do, one thing a lot of studios do, is once you've kind of got the core idea and the core feature set and the core sort of brand platform, then you go and make like a bajillion ways to solve that problem, right? There's a ton of ways to attack. So even if we get hyper specific and we say, okay, it's for guys who are 46 and a half years old, who play golf every third Sunday of the month, yeah, you know, and it's gonna be slick and dark and smooth, right? If we get that whole thing down, there's still thousands of ways to solve that design challenge. So ideation is really the chance to try to quickly iterate through those. For ID, it's a lot of sketching, a lot of sexy sketches you've probably seen cruise around on Google Images. For the UI UX folks, that's probably going to be user flows, it's probably going to be wireframes, ideally something clickable, something you can move through. Ideally, your ID guys are making physical things you can touch pretty early on in the process. And for brand, that might be your, you know, sort of iterations of the logo and palette. And then we get into a more formalized design phase where the ID guys might jump into CAD, might start modeling things. The UX guys might move into more formal wireframes. They might do more click-through prototyping. They might move into actually designing the aesthetic of the UI. Your brand guys might be doing a style guide. And then it's just, you know, iteration and refinement and refinement towards launch. So there's kind of a couple ways you can go about finding these resources. You can do it yourself, you can hire a designer, you can hire a freelancer, or you can work with an agency. There's no right answer. I think it comes down to the size of your company, where your budgets are at, how fast you're trying to move, et cetera, et cetera. So designing it yourself is certainly an option. I don't take the role designer away from anyone who wants to give it to themselves. I think one thing that I've learned as a business professional is that I shouldn't always devote my time to things I'm not great at. So me soldering is like a nightmare, right? I can sort of make something work, but the like 5 hours I spent destroying three boards would probably have been better spent hiring somebody to do it. And I think that's, you know, a way, it's one way to look at design. You know, I think the other option is to say, okay, well, let's bring a designer onto our team. And that's a great option, but I think there's some important considerations. It's like, you know, you gain from bringing this person in this, these sort of shorter, more iterative turnarounds. It's not a client-vendor relationship. They're there at all the meetings. But you have to make sure that you really have created the environment and the space for them to be successful. Designers really thrive on creativity. They thrive on being around other designers. It is a bit of a subjective art, so it's great to get a lot of feedback as they work. As I pointed out before, there's a lot of design roles involved in bringing a great connected product experience to market. Which one of those are you gonna hire? Are they gonna then manage other vendors? How's that gonna work? So I think there's some real value in having a design co-founder, having a designer as part of your early team, but there's also some challenges with it. Freelancers are awesome, and Austin has a great freelance scene. There's a lot of good people. We work with some awesome contractors for certain skill sets we don't have in-house. The challenges, of course, are that, you know, they are in demand, so it's kind of a get in line scenario. They may be juggling multiple clients. Again, you probably won't find one freelancer who's gonna do everything design related. So you get a bunch of them, you try to make them talk to each other, work with each other, make sure you get something cohesive. It's a lot of project management, it's a lot of matchmaking. It's cost effective, but it adds some effort. And working with an agency, agencies range and scale incredibly broadly. Probably the bigger ones we have in town that work on these kind of products are like Frog. On the West Coast, there's a lot of folks, you know, IDEO, Fuse Project, Ammunition, and then all the way down to the kind of medium and smaller guys like us, and kind of everything in between. Bigger agencies look for bigger clients. As a startup, it's pretty hard to, you know, get through the gatekeepers of like a Frog and say, hey, do my project. Not impossible. They do a little bit of equity stuff, but not a ton. You know, if you are going more of the VC route and you can get some bigger dollars, there's definitely West Coast firms that kind of entertain that style of business with really young companies. I think when you're working with an agency, you get some advantages in that, you know, it's more than one person. It's a team of people, so they often know how to work really well together. And you get a deeper, deeper set of skill sets, and you get a deeper pool of resources, so it's easier to keep projects on track, yada, yada, yada. So I think all four are really valid options, and it depends where you are in the process, what your budget looks like, and how fast you're trying to move. But I think with any of them, whether you're hiring a studio or an individual, there's some things to think about, and some things you want to see when you're sort of interviewing these folks. Project scale. Have they worked on anything comparable to what you're working on? Scale in terms of complexity, have they worked in a similar industry? Not a requirement, but definitely helpful, right? If they know the ins and outs of the kinds of approval hurdles you'll have to get through, or they've done a lot of work with the materials that are common to your product, that's really handy. Level of completeness, and this is something I was at a Solid conference a couple weeks ago, and I was talking to, I was listening to a presentation by one of the members of one of the new hardware VC groups out there called Bolt. And he was talking about how many times they've seen, these products come through that are in theory ready to go to manufacturing, but they're not, because they got a freelancer who did this awesome, sketch or did a quick model, and it looks fantastic. Nobody would argue with that, but unfortunately, it just has no consideration for manufacturing in it, and so it's kind of almost back to square one. So you definitely want to understand what you're asking of them and see something to that level. Have they taken a product to shelf? Can I see it? if you don't need that, if you're like, hey, I'm trying to get a really cool rendering because I'm going to go pitch this thing to my angel, and I want them to have a kind of future vision for it, then that's okay. If they can do a sexy rendering, if they're a computer illustrator, that's great. But just understand and see something that represents the level that you're trying to get to with them. Vibe and feeling is important. Like, this is kind of like an arrangement. Like, you're going to work with this person or these people, this team for a while. So like, you kind of got to like them. If they've got a different working style or just a crappy sense of humor or whatever, like, that's important. Know that you're going to have some tense conversations at times. They're going to challenge you. If they're good, they're going to really press you on certain assumptions you've made. So like, you gotta be like, yeah, these people are all right, I can hang out with them. And then understand kind of what their pricing models are. Some freelancers and agencies want pretty big chunks up front. Some are willing to entertain equity deals, some like royalty deals. So see what works for you, see what's in your process, and make sure that comes up early in the conversation. And then IP, unless you're doing some sort of interesting equity swap thing, you should retain all of your IP. Just watch out. If any designer agency is saying that they're gonna own some part of that in the master service agreement, just walk away. Not a standard in our industry. All right, only like 62 more slides. We're so close. No. I'm going to try to pick it up here. We're very close to the end. We sort of talked about why it's important, who you can work with. I'll give you a couple tips for how to work with these folks. One thing, and this is just my sort of, I own a creative agency, here's my wish list. Not quite. Starting on the right foot is really important, and by that I mean, again, sort of if the designer's not being involved in the sort of initial strategy phase and really focusing the mission, then you need to clearly get them briefed on what the mission is. If they're not fully bought in and they don't totally understand what you're trying to accomplish, why you're trying to accomplish it, what are still the open assumptions, what things you've figured out, like, a really thorough briefing is really critical. And just share everything. Everyone always sort of holds back, like, oh, I don't want to, like, let them see this thing, because then they'll think that's the way it has to be done. A good design team doesn't think that way. They want to see every mistake you've made, everything you've tried. They're still going to push new and fresh ideas. They're not going to be like, oh, look, you figured it out. It's round. Got it round. Be really upfront about your timeline and budget. There's no point in getting halfway through the project And then being like, you know what, guys, can we speed it up? Because I actually have this opportunity. I need it over here. It's just any firm, any freelancer, they're going to have multiple projects on the go. It's just unrealistic. You know, again, it's like the process feels sometimes a little waterfall-y still. And I think most design firms are sort of looking to the sort of world of lean startup to try to find shorter iteration cycles. But there's certain things that really can't be rushed. There's certain processes, this digestion time. It's designers are still kind of artists at the core. And as much as we want to make this a very data-driven pursuit, and it can be, there still needs to be this room, this breathing room to do good work. And if you kind of force the timing too much, you can start to erode the value that you're paying for. Pretty much the last thing here is feedback. I think a lot of folks struggle with giving feedback on creative pursuits like design objects. I think I see sort of two ends of the spectrum. You know, the people who just come in like a hammer and just crush the design team because it's so wrong. There's nothing wrong with saying, hey, you guys missed the mark. But you know, realize that if you hired a good team, they probably worked their butt off some nights, some weekends. So try not kid gloves, just kind. And then I also see, and this is almost really more dangerous, is the people on the other end of the spectrum who are just like, it's good, yeah. And then like after the eighth deliverable, they're like, you know, here's the thing though, I actually don't want it to be round. And you know, because they're just so, you guys were just working so hard, I didn't want to crush your feelings. And it's like, man, I wish you had told me that six rounds ago. So I think it's all about honesty. It's all about just giving true feedback as you would in any other world. All right. Summaries are horrible. But anyway, I'll summarize. All right. Really trying to have that core focus throughout the process is critical. Think about building experiences, not products. Don't think about the thing that's dropping in the box being your completion state. Think about what's it like to open the box? What's it like to turn it on? What's it like to log into the website? Does it match my clothes? You know, think about these experience points that your user's gonna have, and that's what you're designing. And the sum of those is the thing that you're making, not the thing that dropped in the box. You know, try to bring design thinking in early to the table. Maybe you got a friend, a colleague who does it, who can help you out kind of on the cheap or free, just be an advisor, stimulate your thinking early on until you're really ready to bring in a professional new team. Really validate those partners carefully and find a good fit and be flexible. All right, thank you guys so much. Can you do a couple questions?
Yeah.
All right, I'm here. You can tell me all the things I told you that were wrong, especially if you're a designer.
You touched on something really important that you were talking about, manufacturing experience and this disconnect between the fabulous image and then the actual process. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, he was mentioning this idea of the disconnect between a beautiful product rendering and say what's actually factory ready. When we meet entrepreneurs and we tell them how much time it takes and how much money it costs to get from nothing to a product on shelf, there's always this like, no. And it's always that much or more. And the challenge for that is because it's really hard. That last bit is really hard. The bit of saying, I have a vision, it works like this, here's the experience I'm going after, it's gonna be beautiful. To getting from that vision to something that is manufactured to a way that meets all the criteria of the feature set, whether you've got thermals to think about, whether you've got shielding or signal, all the complexity of, especially if you're doing like a consumer electronic device, all the complexity of properly packaging that, and then you've got a manufacturer who introduces a whole other set of complexity, right? Because even if it's like, well, it's an injection molding. Well, all injection molders aren't the same injection molder. They all have their little tricks, their ways of doing things. All right, now you're speccing this material over that material. So having gone through that process many, many times is a huge asset in your designer, right? Because they know the pitfalls. And really, one of our very early steps, and I think this is not uncommon among good design firms, is that We're digging into materials and manufacturing process in our ideation phase, because in many ways they can be really inspirational drivers, not just like this headache to deal with at the end of the process. So it's absolutely critical. I think if you're trying to evaluate a partner, try to see some things they've made, try to hear their war stories. It's never 100% smooth. Never drop some cat off at the factory and come back 3 months later for our first sample. It doesn't work that way. There's always going to be a negotiation, but you want that negotiation to be as painless as possible, and you want that design intent not to get completely obliterated during that process, right? We've all seen the thing where you have the render on one side and then the thing that got made on the other, and it's like this blocky monster. That happens, and it happens all too often. So if you're looking for a design partner that's going to take you all the way through your production units, definitely ask to see some of the stuff they've worked on and hear some of their war stories.
So if your startup clients knew something, what would you wish they knew, and where would they go to at least know something out of an intelligent conversation?
So if we were trying to educate our startup clients, I would probably say go to YouTube, and I would watch a bunch of how things are made videos. Because if you think like, all right, we want to do milled aluminum, or we want to do injection molded plastic, if you've got a vision, if you've got some excitement around a material or a process, there's a ton of information. It's super available. So go in, check it out, see what works. There's great, really dorky manufacturing forums you can check out and hear everyone's like horror stories of what they didn't do right. Factory tours are awesome. There's like, I think one blow molder in Austin. And so, but there are places and you can reach out, and they're often really cool, especially if you're like, yeah, I'm not ready now, but I'm looking for a US manufacturer. A lot of people throw you on a factory tour, see how it's actually done. Those are some ways I'd go into it.
I'm gonna add to that a little bit. I'm the other partner that at Pushstart. I think the other thing that's pretty key in the process that gets left out sometimes is the communication.
Is that loud enough?
Sorry.
I was going to say the other key is in the process is the communication with manufacturer. And I think a lot of times there's this thought, especially overseas manufacturing, that you're basically just going to go through the process, wait and see what you get, and then go back and forth 3 or 4 times and you're good to go. I think a lot of people hesitate to get on a plane, and I would say that there's definitely points in which you need to get on that plane and go overseas, meet your manufacturing partner. And I think we advise that a lot. I know there's another designer here, Ty, that has some soft goods experience as well, and that's another tricky one that's even more so tricky with the sampling process. Always recommend going overseas and actually working directly with your partner, get prototypes real time, see what's going on. So.
Other questions?
Could you talk more about validation?
You mean to validate first samples and things coming off the line, or to validate the idea itself? Ah, yeah. That's a good one. I'm always amazed at how many people walk in our door who haven't done like just a full-on weekend Google madness fest of trying to dig down and find if their idea exists. And generally, I mean, maybe you just came up with something that's awesome that's just never been done and no one has ever thought of. That's so rare. Usually there's a reason people haven't done the thing you're trying to do. And a lot of the way we like to validate is to go figure out why other people failed at things and to look for if we have a different approach to it, right? That's a lot of it. Survey is really helpful. I think that like a lot of people feel like doing just their own customer research is not feasible, but like, one of the techniques I love is to do a survey on like SurveyMonkey, right? Where we might do a quick sketch of the idea or just write a description of it, and maybe ask a couple questions about price point or, would you use this, what would you pay, yada, yada. And then you can do super targeted Facebook ads. So if you think you know who your demographic is, moms who have kids who live in, well, I guess if they're moms, they'd have kids. Moms who have kids who live in the suburbs. You get these like hyper demographic things, and it's super cheap, right? drive some traffic, promise a $50 Amazon gift card to, you know, drawing or whatever, and funnel people through your survey, get some feedback. If somebody's really interesting, says cool stuff, email them up, say, hey, I love, thanks so much for filling out the survey. Could you spare 15 minutes for a quick call? You could probably get like a 50% hit rate. And now you're networked to people well outside of your direct community who have no incentive to help you. So that's some of like the really early validation stuff we do. But again, it's like, what's like the smallest, cheapest prototype you can build? And that doesn't necessarily a feature-based prototype, not necessarily even an electronics-based prototype, but like what's the smallest, cheapest thing you could put in front of somebody that they could react to and go, yeah, I'd be interested in that. Those are some of the really like lo-fi routes we go.
Can you share a couple names of success stories that maybe Austin-based businesses have gone to the shelf with you guys?
Austin's tough because it's a kind of young market for us. We're actually mostly working with folks outside of Austin. And interestingly enough, our business is probably 70% like Fortune 50s right now. And that's kind of what we came up with. And we're actually really shifting our focus now. So we're working with a lot of really cool startups right now, which I can't probably tell you too much about. But our to shelf with our startup group is pretty slim, to be honest.
Yeah. Most of our work is with those Fortune 100s, I'd say. There's a lot of it does come down to that kind of manufacturing interaction, and we help a lot with that process. That's kind of where our earnings come from. There's things like, actually there's Dell monitors back there. It's a project we worked on way back in the day. But there's definitely a lot of things. And then there's a lot of things that are on their way as well. So
One of my favorite smaller clients that we work with is a group out of Seattle called Mir, and they do a series of water bottles and now bicycles and growlers and bags. So not connected devices, but a really cool company and super small team. And what they cared a lot about was giving back and giving back to Wells Project specifically in Africa. And they came to us basically and said, hey, we've got a great connection to a stainless steel bottle manufacturer in China. And this was sort of the time of BPA scare and Clean Canteen and SIG being really dominant players in the market. And the question was like, do we need another, like is another metal water bottle? Like, is there any room left in this market? But what was really cool is because they knew how much margin was in these things and they weren't that greedy. They were open to the idea of taking less margin and trying to be a little bit of a price player, but also trying to find a new brand to go after. And so we sort of went through the process with them of targeting in on their brand was this sort of weekend warrior space. You know, Clean Canteen and SIG, they don't express a lot. They're just kind of nice, simple forms. They lean a little more sort of feminine in their appeal. It wasn't like a guy's stainless steel water bottle. Some sounds kind of silly, right? But it's like, you know, for guys. So that was the space that we found. Finding these kind of like urban guys who like to get out, would be interested in a give back program, you know, emotionally mature men. And what's been great is to watch their evolution as we've tacked more and more products onto the product line, all dating back to that original brand promise. And so that's why when I say it's like really important to try to get that stuff in early and build that into your DNA, it's become like you know, a well that we can just keep going back to find new ways to bring new products to the market in a way that feels really cohesive. So that's one kind of small, they were, you know, one guy, two guys, I think when we started, and now they're a team of about 12. They got a showroom opening. I think they're doing, last year was like maybe about $5 million in sales, so they're doing great. Hey, it's Dave.
Are you hiring?
Are we hiring? Hey, thanks, Dave. yes, we are looking to bring a technologist into our midst. We've had some fantastic partner relationships. In fact, worked with Mark for a little bit on a project back in the day, and we've had some great EE and ME partners over the years, and we plan to continue to work with them. But I think very much as I've been pitching how important it is to bring design into your hardware development process, we're really interested in bringing hardware development into our design process. It's something that, you know, we don't want to be in that waterfall state where everything's sort of building up to the prototype. We want to be prototyping as we go. And like I said, we've had great success with good partners, but nothing better than having somebody sit with you at the table. So looking for that sort of super person that does everything, because that would be awesome. But we're realistic. If you are looking for an opportunity to work on a lot of different stuff, or if you know somebody who is and they've got that really, they're really eager to learn and try new stuff and don't get scared of doing something they haven't done before, then pass them our way, or pass yourself our way. Anything else? Good?
Oh, I had a question. Can you talk a little bit about your iteration process? Like, do you make prototypes on site, or do you have like a favorite machine house, or what do y'all do?
Yeah, we do a bunch of everything. So for like physical prototyping of non-electronic component kind of stuff? Yeah. Or electronic. Yeah.
Whatever you want to say about it.
Yeah. So we prototype in probably, you know, three kind of categories. One is quick and dirty. We have a small shop in-house, you know, sawdust, drills, wood, foam core, and that's for sort of like scale models and just getting quick sense of thing. Oh, that would be impossible to hold, you know, just really gut check kind of stuff. Because man, it's so much better to do that. You spend all this time building this cat model, looks super sweet, and then you like print the first one, and you're like, oh man. And then we do sort of appearance model or physical models, things that we need to see and understand in reality, but at a higher level of detail. A lot of 3D printing. We have a 3D printer in house, but there's also some great 3D printers in town if you need something of a higher fidelity.
What kind of printer?
Ours is an Ultimaker 2, I think. We did something really fun, and if you're ever thinking about buying a 3D printer, I highly recommend it if you have the time. You can send a CAD file to pretty much any 3D printer manufacturer and ask them to send you a sample. And I think about 8 out of 10 people actually did. that's a really fun project, and we love the Ultimaker for its price. It's incredible. I mean, it's like $2,000, something, $3,000 maybe. And compared to like the MakerBot, we thought it was a lot better. But there's a guy who's got a great like Objet 500 up on North Lamar that prints great stuff. There's a lot of great quick turn overnight services. Proto Labs offers almost like everything now. They'll do even like super short run injection molding if you need like, you know, 1,000 parts. Milling of metals, almost every metal you can think of, plastics. Who's in town, right?
Solid Concepts. RPM is one of the folks that do visual. Those are more kind of high finish and short run prototype shops.
Yeah, so that's sort of the next level to graduate to, is that real like looks like model. So like, let's say you need, you know, you've got the guts figured out, but you really need something that looks just awesome, like a real product. You can send those overseas. It's incredibly cheap to get done overseas. I hate to sort of say it, but it's about a third the cost to do it in the States. You just have to have the patience to wait for it to make the trip. Those are some folks who are
just... I think this is a good answer.
All right, can we do it? Oh.
Hi, is this from basically help your clients to find people who are interested in the idea of their minimum viable product. But I've just noticed that there is such a difference between people who are interested and people who will actually like shell out the cash. So do you help your clients to find more people who are willing to shell it out specifically, and how so?
That's an awesome question. So the question was around, it's easy to get people to say like, yeah, that's a great idea, you should totally make it. It's a much different thing to ask them to actually give you money for it. And we know that it's not there until the money has changed hands. I think, you know, a lot of our clients, and I don't think it's a surprising answer, but a lot of our clients are looking to crowdfunding sites, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, to use as a validation tool, whether they actually need the funding or not. There are a lot of rules these days on Kickstarter about sort of like ghostware, not putting things up that aren't really real. And I sort of believe in that, you know, just as a human, as a potential consumer of Kickstarters, to not do it too early. But I think that you can get pretty quickly into the process to a point where you've validated sort of your cost structures after the fact to actually go forward and see if you can get traction there. You can certainly try to recruit and filter to find folks that, it's tough. It's honestly tough to find people if you're very early stage and you don't have a lot to show to them to try to really know if they'd actually shell out the money for it. I think the best is probably to look at analogous products, people who have bought things that you think have enough of a corollary map to what you're doing. So it's in hair care, it's a consumer electronic in hair care that's gonna have a $220 price point. Okay, are there any like super fancy hair dryers at that point? You know, trying to like find something analogous that you can say like, okay, this person has bought a thing that I think is similar to this. So if they'd say they'd buy it, it's a lot closer probably. So it's a tough one. You ask a good question. Hey, it's Ty.
Mine's more of a comment building on what Adrian said about the project brief and that being really agreed to and pricing, things like that up front. I've been on the consulting side and on the corporate side and the manufacturing side and the design side. And probably one of the top three things I see is people that go to Asia and they don't have a manufacturing agreement or a purchasing agreement. People think, oh, you gotta be a big company to do that, but actually agreeing to those basic terms, and it can be very simple, like two pages. You know, this is the price, this is what you're gonna do. You expect the price to go down on volume. You gotta put everything in there. And they're very open to that. If they're not open to signing an agreement like that, and not that you have any legal recourse, you may not have the money to take them to court, you know, or try to sue them if something bad goes wrong, but they're not willing to sign that, same kind of thing, just walk away. Because, you want to work with somebody who wants to be open to working with you and totally transparent, so.
You've seen it gone wrong.
I've seen it gone wrong.
Done?
Thank you.
All right, thank you guys so much.
I'm just Adrian at pushstartcreative.com.
If you send them to me, I'll post them on the Meetup. And sorry, say your email again.
Adrian, A-D-R-I-A-N, at pushstartcreative.com.
Awesome. Thanks, Adrian. We are at the point in our Meetup where we like to do some just brief announcements. I know a few of you have just a few things you'd like to share, so we'll do a pass the mic. I'll hand the mic to the first person who wants to start, and then just hand it off to the next person. So who's first? Jess. Of course, all the way in the third.
Hi guys, sorry I was late. So I just wanted to let you all know, for those of you who aren't aware, there is a local meetup here in Austin that just started, Women Hardware Hackers. So as the name suggests, it's for women who are interested in hardware hacking. At the moment, our group is kind of tailored towards beginners, so doing some study groups around Raspberry Pis and Arduinos. We're gearing up for a larger event in early 2016, which will hopefully be appealing to beginners and experienced people alike. For Austin's first women-only hardware hackathon. So I appreciate that most of the demographic in the room are not necessarily women, but I'm hoping that you will, you know, spread it with the women in your lives, you know, who may be interested in a women-only space where they can kind of learn about hardware and kind of get familiar with it. It's a language agnostic environment. I kind of grew out of PyLadies, which is a Python specific group. But you know, it is a language agnostic group. So people who are C inclined, JavaScript inclined, any language at the moment, we're kind of interested in having you. So we're really excited. We just had our first meetup. We'll have another one in a couple of weeks. Really keen to have people who are interested just kind of show up, get involved. We're also interested in sponsors, so if you think this is an initiative you'd like to support, please come talk to me afterwards. I'm happy to answer any other questions people have. Great.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Yes, there's the hand.
I missed it.
No, he didn't raise it until I pointed him five times.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Lamar Benz. I'm the CEO of Creative Hardware Staff and Solutions. We are the premier staffer for hardware technology companies. My headquarters, new headquarters, is out of Dallas, but I have satellite offices here as well as out in the Bay Area. So we're looking for hardware CEOs and founders who is looking to staff up their embedded systems engineers, their CPU engineers, analog mixed signal engineers, as well as firmware engineers. So see me afterwards. I noticed some of the speakers are looking for various folks, so feel free to see me after the meeting, and you know, we can discuss how we can work together.
Anyone else? Doesn't have to be a big announcement, just something you're working on, like some feedback.
Hi, my name is Scott Allen, and I'm a mechanical engineer, but I work for a company called Nuvei that started out of the Capital Factory, and we're looking for an electrical engineer who has firmware based background, Internet of Things. If you have any interest, just stop by and I'll fill you in.
Okay, thanks everyone. Just a couple points. Adrian mentioned DC called Polt. They're actually out of Boston. They are actually going to be sponsoring and coming to our next meetup in August. So one of the questions you're wondering is, how do I raise money for my beautifully designed product? I encourage you to look out for the announcement. I think it's August 20th, but we typically meet the third Thursday of every month. So if I got the date wrong, it's the third Thursday of August. Please eat some more pizza, drink the rest of the drinks, and thanks again for coming. Appreciate it.